is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Unspoiled, covering the Dresden Files, Book 11, Turncoat, Chapters 20, 21, and 22. In these chapters, Harry, Molly, and Morgan escape into the Never-Never, and we found out how exactly Morgan was keeping himself secret. Also, other things.
Huh.
Welcome to Unspoiled. I'm a rolling thunder! I think I'm going to start every episode with an intro that says something and then also other things. Because when will that not be true? Welcome to the show, everybody. I am Natasha.
I'm Rashawn.
So, these chapters. We have a couple of Molly moments. I appreciated that Molly is the one to talk both Harry and Morgan down when they start yelling at each other very loud in fucking the Never Never.
Yes, yes.
Because Morgan is super, super convinced that Harry is making a mistake trusting Thomas. The fact that Harry calls him Thomas is in and of itself something that Morgan thinks is dangerous.
Right.
Morgan's calling him the vampire. Meanwhile, Morgan is like shivering and probably has an infection. It seems like he's feverish. So he's not doing super well. And they're both basically, everybody's under a lot of stress. Okay.
Yeah.
So they're all just, like, lashing out at one another.
Yeah. Everyone is a little frayed around the edges.
Mm-hmm.
It's cold where they are now. They're tired. They had to lug Morgan up the trail, and then he had to go back and get the wheelchair.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone's tense.
Yeah. Yeah, not handicap-accessible trails. And this is when Harry, like, they're talking about how Binder and his goons could possibly have known where they are. And Molly points out, because of course Morgan thinks Thomas gave them up.
Mm-hmm.
And Molly's like, if Thomas gave us up, he knew precisely which unit we were in. Why would he have just been generally at the storage area, but not just go to us right away? And this leads them to a conclusion that they don't really share with Molly. They just wind up saying, oh, we're going to go back to my place. Mm-hmm. And did you get what they were saying when they said that? Because I sure didn't. I was so confused by this.
No, I didn't understand that they had both sort of understood what was happening, which is that they were being kind of just tailed by a, you know, by something.
By some regular old person.
Mm-hmm.
And we find out that Morgan is hidden because he called in his marker. He got one of the little silver oak leaves when, it was Titania, right? That came? Or no, it was Lily. Was it Lily who came?
It says, Harry starts to say Titania in this chapter.
Oh, right. Okay. I forgot he like says her name. But I think that it was Lily that actually showed up on Titania's behalf. Because she comes in to the what's supposed to be Molly's execution. And she was the one who had helped Harry earlier with Fix to get Molly out of Arctis Tor. So I think she was the one who turns up as well.
Okay.
You know what I mean? With the oak leaf. But yeah, so Morgan called in his marker to stay hidden. But Harry remembers that these come with a little bit of fine print that he didn't know about, and now and Morgan does not know about, and that probably, if she wanted to, she could easily sell Morgan out. And they don't necessarily think that's what happened here. They haven't yet put it all together. But it's possible that she has both kept her promise and fulfilled his marker and also given up his position.
Right. That's that little loophole that they're famous for.
Mm-hmm.
Because if someone else figures out what spell to look for, then, you know, she can be like, well, I didn't actually tell them anything. Yeah, she's crafty.
They're all fucking crafty. I need to, like, get on that level. It's a real Slytherin level. Sort of level. Yeah, you know? So, this is when Harry's like, we're going back to my place, and Molly's like, that? I guess I should be the apprentice, because that sounds really fucking stupid to me. Why are we going back there? And Harry says, watch and learn. And then we go to chapter 21. They're eating donuts. I forgot that Morgan says.
Yes.
He's making fun of Harry. Well, it's no donut. And apparently everybody's talking about Harry doing that.
Harry's like, well, how did you even hear about that? He's like, oh, it's news.
It's the talk of the town, kid.
Right? The streets are talking.
So they are waiting for this little creature to come around. And all of a sudden, here's Tutu. We haven't seen him in a minute.
I love this little intro. And I love this whole, I forgot about the Pizza Lord thing.
Yeah.
And his little outfit that he's wearing with his little piece of golf ball is his helmet. Come on. It's adorable.
The Zalord.
It is, it's so rewarding because he's like fully, you know, and it's his choice to be serving, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So it just, I don't know. It's just, it's fun. It's a delight.
Yeah, I really don't. I forget how much I enjoy Tutu. Like, I sort of have a reaction to him in some ways as I did to Dobby initially, where I'm like, oh, God, okay, here we go. And then once he starts talking, I'm like, oh, yeah, he's really funny. Like, the way the interactions that him and Harry have are actually. Dobby, no offense, RIP, but Dobby is, he is so fawning that it's like painful a little bit, you know? The way that he is just like, Harry Potter is so brave and so wise and so, you know, yada, yada, yada. And two, like, yeah, he loves Harry, but it's not like he has to do all of this, like, flowery bullshit while talking to him. He'll just be like, you want me to kill him? And we know that means that he's loyal. Listen, when you have a friend that you tell them about somebody who's like fucking with you, and their immediate response is to react with violence on your behalf, that's a good friend. That's all I'm saying.
Yep, that's the kind of friend you want to have in your life.
Yep. Do you ever think about, like, scenarios that would never happen and how you would react to them in terms of, like, getting in fights with people? Because I think about it all the time. I'm, like, so waiting for one of these moments to present themselves, and I don't know if it's ever going to happen. And if I, like, live to a ripe old age and never get in a fight, I'm going to be so disappointed. I'm going to be real bummed. I just, like, I have thought about, depending on the type of person, how hard I'm going to go with my shit talk first, whether or not I'm going to get in their face and give them a chance to, like, back down, or if I'm just going to go full on, like, quarterback body tackle. Because, like, I am no joke when it comes to a body tackle. I am heavy. I am strong. I have strong legs. Owen one time was trying to resist me, and he was standing in the doorway of our bedroom, and he had grabbed onto both door jams. And I came up on him and knocked him back onto the bed, no problem. He was holding onto things for dear life and couldn't do it. So I feel like I could really fuck somebody up if I just, like, kind of rhinoed my way into the center mass of their body.
Mm-hmm.
I could send them flying.
That's not a bad plan.
I reserve that for the tall ones and the mean mm-hmm. ones. Because you got to throw the mean ones off their game a little bit. And they don't expect that, I would assume. For somebody to just, like, come at you like an angry bull. You know?
I like how well thought out this all is.
Yeah, well, you know, I feel like you need strategies. And if you do a little one, especially if it's somebody old, because, like, I might get in a fight with somebody old. I don't know. Old people are vicious. Heckling them?
You don't give a fuck?
I'll heckle them much sooner than I'll get violent with an old person. I will get in their face, like, an inch away and be like, I see you already use a walker.
Shut up. Don't even finish that.
You know, like, just I'm giving you a shot here where you could just turn around and walk away. You don't have to do this. None of us has to do this. But because I, you know, there are some people where, you know, you can get the vibe as to whether they can be reasoned with and brought down from the edge. And then there are people where you can tell they're just like, they're gonna go for it, so you need to beat them to the punch, literally.
I gotta get me a good plan.
Yeah, think it through.
I should. I need to put some more energy into that. I've been slacking. All right. Let me make a note.
So, it turns out that Toot has been sent on a mission to keep an eye on some dude who has been watching Harry's apartment. And Toot describes this camera.
Oh my god, this is so cute. It's ridiculous.
Harry says, how do you know this guy is watching my apartment? Oh, don't tell me this one. Toot jittered back and forth in place, bobbing in excitement. Because he has curtains on the windows so you can't see in. And then there's a big black plastic box with a really long nose poking through them and a glass eye on the end of the nose. And he looks at the back of it all the time. And when he sees someone going into your house, he pushes a button and the box beeps. Bless him. I love him so much.
I was like, what is he describing?
Did it take you that long? Yeah, I guess I could see that. I'm so used to this description now, having read this one like four times, and I immediately know. But if I think back to how it was the first time, I could see being like, what the fuck are you talking about, dude?
And the car.
Oh, right. Where he just does the Y.
Yes.
She stands so that Harry knows that it's a Mercedes.
Oh.
I
love, too, when Harry is talking about his relationship with Toot and the Wee Folks and how it's grown.
Mm-hmm.
And also how he probably knows them better than any other wizard because of the amount of time he spent with them.
Yeah.
So he takes great care in how he talks to Toot. Like, he doesn't, like, laugh at him when he offers to kill somebody, maybe.
Oh, my God. I love just how, like, I'm not trying to say Toot couldn't kill anybody. I believe he could, honestly.
If he really wanted to, I'm sure he could work it out.
Yeah. But I am saying that crime scene would be a fucking mess. Because Toot would have to, like, slice that guy up. He's got a little jigsaw blade.
Mm-hmm.
For his, like, how many cuts do you have to make for somebody to die from that? That would be horrifying. This guy would be covered in all of these, like, kind of small little cuts. Like, yeah. And also, like, this poor dude, we learn when we meet him, that this dude is just a vanilla mortal. He's not somebody with experience on this dark side shit. So how terrified would you be if this, like, cat-sized thing just pops up flying in the air, coming at you with tiny little... And maybe he'd bring his friends, and they'd all gang up on you like a cloud around you.
This sounds horrible.
Right? I just, like, ugh, no thank you. That just... it's, like, treated as kind of a joke, like, oh, shall I slay him? And you're like, oh, toot, you silly. But, like, think about how that would go down. That'd be fucked up. That's all I'm saying. Okay, so Harry goes up to the, he goes to the street in front of the window and points at it and gestures for whoever's in there to come out. And immediately he sees some dude, like, come running out of the building, run to his car and try and get into the car. But the second mission that Toot had been sent on was to fill the guy's car lock with bubblegum and deflate his tires. And so he realizes that he is good and caught, and he just goes, well, shit.
Yeah, they disconnected something from the engine, too.
Right, I forgot about that.
They were all up in that car.
Yep. Yeah, and when he says something about bubblegum to Harry, he's like, I could have made it super glue. This can be removed. We'll say we're friends because of that. Consider it a professional courtesy. So Harry gets in the car with him and questions him, and he's basically like, I didn't know anybody was getting hurt. Yeah. And because of that, I will quit this job. But I'm not telling you who hired me.
And Harry tries real hard to get him to give him that information, too. Mm-hmm. He tries to kind of threaten him with calling the police. That doesn't do anything.
Yeah.
He tells the guy that, you know, well, you're trying to get me killed. You're helping someone, you know, try to kill me.
Mm-hmm.
And this guy's just like, nah, I'm not telling you who I work for. And Harry ends up not even badgering him because he kind of respects it.
Yeah. Which I like, but I felt like he was giving up a little too easy.
Mm-hmm.
There was a part of me that was like, is this the Harry that we know? Because I feel like he wouldn't necessarily have pushed this guy, but he might have followed him. Like, gone back to the guy's office, try to get into his, like, files and see whose name he comes up with. You know what I mean?
Something.
I don't know.
He just gives up and walks away.
Yeah.
Of course, if he doesn't give up, we don't get, you know, the next scene with Molly.
Right. So, yeah, Molly hears that this dude is still out there and that he's young. And she's like, oh, I got this.
Fucking Morgan freaks out.
Oh, my God. He totally does. I forgot about that. Because she's like, don't worry. I'll change his mind. And Morgan, I would rather die. Do you hear me? Rather die. And she's just standing there with an eyebrow raised, looking at him like, wow. And then she turns to Harry and says, you're right. He is a drama queen, which I found hilarious because he is, though.
He is. He really is. I think he knows it, too.
I think so.
He knows. So she goes out there after having taken her bra off because, you know, boobs.
Yeah.
And
behold the power of boobs.
Goes on out there with two beers and comes back, sure enough, with the name of the person who sent him.
Mm-hmm.
So...
worked.
Hooray, boobs.
Worked out. Hooray, boobs. Yeah, they do some sort of, like, little dance about how, like, well, he couldn't just tell me what I needed to know. So I assured him that I was really worried about my future with you. What if something happened to you, kind of thing? And what if I needed some, like, a new job? And... there's a moment where Morgan is, like, kind of looking at her like, wow.
Yeah, well, she takes her bra.
And Harry's like, dude, what are you doing? And Morgan says that there's nothing wrong with appreciating a woman's beauty, but Harry is disturbed by it. He's not like this.
Yeah. Yeah, you don't like it much, do you, Harry?
Yeah, Harry's just, you know, real sensitive over here for somebody who has the thoughts that we are in his head to see. We know. We know. Don't act like we don't know. So, yeah, she comes back with the information. There is a particular law firm that Harry has been indirectly instructed to go and check out. So he heads over there. And this is the part where I'm really like, you can't criticize fucking Morgan for his reaction and then have the reaction that you do to the assistant, dude. Because come on. We'll get there in a moment. First, he runs into the security guard. The security guard who does... He is not here for Harry's fucking charming, roguish attitude.
Not even a little bit.
Oh, man. He is so, like... It feels like... And I'm sure this isn't true, but you get the feeling that he's just like, I get this every day. You aren't cute. I'm tired. Stop it.
Yeah. I love that he found Harry to be completely unremarkable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Harry's trying to be like, he's trying to pull a Gandalf. You wouldn't part an old man from his walking stick. Like, you're not fooling anybody, old man. It's a old Ozark folk art, sir. Please hand over the Ozark folk art. From Mr. What does he say? From Mr. Wise Ass? Yeah, received 1 6-foot traditional Ozark walking club from Mr. Smartass. That's Dr. Smartass, I said. I didn't spend 8 years in insult college to be called Mr. And the guy just doesn't respond to him at all that time. He just sits down and just like goes back to his fucking newspaper is how I imagine it.
In my head, he's like Stanley from The Office.
Ooh, I love it. Yes, just a stare. Pulls out a slice of pizza from his fanny pack.
Oh my God, if that isn't a whole move.
So yeah, we get this thing, which just irritated me so bad. And I know that Butcher has gotten way better about the male gaze in general, but this was a return to form that I found so fucking annoying. The receptionist was, inevitably, a young woman, and just as unavoidably attractive. What the fuck does that even mean? What are you even talking about? I have met many receptionists above the age of 60, so I don't know what inevitably means. Just as unavoidably attractive. What is that? She went with the silk oak, solid oak furnishings, the actual oil paintings, and the handcrafted furniture in the reception area, variations on a theme of beautiful practicality. Whoa, dude, you just literally equated a human woman to the furniture in the fucking room. Are you serious? Holy shit, like they picked her out of a catalog. And we're like, yeah, no, she looks
That's
right.
That's basically what he's saying. You know? That's exactly what he's saying.
She looked up at me with a polite smile, her dark hair long and appealing, her shirt cut just low enough to make you notice, but not so low as to make you think less of her. Oh, really? Oh, okay, so note, there's a point at which you think less of women based solely on what they're wearing. Cool, good to know. Fuck you. Fuck everybody involved in these sentences. Hate them. Next.
Ugh. Yeah, it's been a while since we got something that egregious.
That I mean, really just, like, oh, it got under my skin so bad.
It's so needless. Mm-hmm. Like, it doesn't add anything to any fucking thing.
Yep.
It's just there. Serving no purpose.
Yep.
Just wasting everybody's time.
That is exactly true. I think that's part of what did it. That she isn't even the one that he winds up having the most interactions with.
Nope.
No. So there's no need to give us any of this because it doesn't wind up mattering or playing into anything at all.
Mm-hmm.
And then she directs him to addiction counseling because she sees his rough-looking self and is like, oh, yeah, you can't afford to talk to our lawyers.
He was just starting to feel better about himself, too, having made it onto the elevator.
And she gives him this big smile, and he's like, oh, well, I guess I've made a good... And then she's just like, oh, yeah, you're looking for AA? It's upstairs. So, yeah. He then has to kind of push through in order to see Evelyn Derrick, and he came here on purpose during lunch hour... Because Evelyn Derrick, who would have had an assistant that he'd probably have been foisted off on, does not have her assistant at hand to foist him on at this moment. Apparently, Evelyn Derrick herself does not take a lunch hour.
I mean, right?
I found that a little weird. I don't know. I'm not a lawyer. I mean, lawyers, like, not lunch.
What are the odds that only one of them would go? Like, he's so certain it would. He's so certain based on. Nothing. just a hunch.
Yep.
I mean, and there's nothing wrong with having a hunch, but call it a fucking hunch.
Yes. Oh, this is exactly as I planned. So he goes in and he's like walking through this fucking law firm that is just so expensive. He says that they would have been seethingly jealous of the ostentatiatory.
I appreciated that callback.
Yes. So he walks in, and Evelyn keeps on typing and does not even look at him for like a full 2 minutes and leaves him just standing there.
This is some Jack Donaghy shit.
Yeah.
How to maintain the upper hand in a meeting.
Never start talking first. And then it's just him and Lemon sitting across from each other in silence for 5 minutes. I love it. And eventually she's just like, I hope you don't think I'm going to hire you again.
So old boy was like not playing when he said he was going to quit the job.
Yeah.
And he made short work of it too. There was no dilly-dallying.
Yeah. Again.
I kind of like some this fucking guy.
Yeah, right? Same. Integrity. That's the word I wanted. Some reason that word slipped my mind. I just haven't used it a lot lately for some reason. Weird.
Trenchant.
So, as she says, Mr. Graver, I hope that you don't think I'm going to hire you again. She still does not look at him. And Harry is just like, all right, you know what, bitch? Two can play at the not looking or talking game. And he chooses to wait and not say anything. He says, I debated several answers and decided to start things off by annoying her. I know. Me. Shocking, right? So he just waits until she finally looks up. And then he says, hi, Cuddles. Which... odd choice, but I liked it in its way.
I laughed pretty hard at that, actually. It's just so stupid.
So she puts her hands flat on her, like, spotless glass desktop, and he just says, you're gonna leave smudges. Because he just can't fucking help it. And she tells him to get out. And he hexes all of her electronics. He means to just hex the phone.
Mm-hmm. But precision has never really been his thing.
That's so true. Oh, man, that is very, very true.
Yeah. I feel like Molly could have handled that very quickly.
Interesting.
Or Elaine, even, but, yeah, not Harry.
Yeah, because we see, like, Elaine definitely has precision. With Molly, that's an interesting question, because, like, she's so good at mental stuff, but in terms of, like, this would be an actual forceful sort of... I don't know if she would be or not. She might, because it's not, like... violent. Mm-hmm. It's just sort of like directing your magic. So Ms. Derek is jumps and tries to go in several directions because the sparks come out of her computer, out of her phone, out of the pocket of her jacket, and she's just trying to avoid everything at the same time. So she winds up on the floor.
Harry is also a drama queen.
That's so true. Takes one to fucking no one, Harry Dresden. So yeah, she collapses on the ground, and Harry's like, I want you to tell me who had you hire a detective to snoop on me. And she's like, I don't know what you're talking about. To which he uses magic to summon a bottle of bourbon from her liquor cabinet and just take a swig and get in her face a little bit more and say, are you sure? And he realizes that, like, her reaction to this means that she has no experience with magic. She has not seen this before. She did not know this was a thing. Which I think he initially interprets as whomever hired her is either not of the magical community or they did not reveal to her that they are of the magical community.
Right.
We wind up finding out that her brain has been fucked with.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I'm not entirely sure if she knew when her brain was being fucked with, or if she did, that it was like magic that was happening to her. You said it felt as if she didn't know.
Right. Because there's a part where Harry starts talking about how quickly the human mind will believe a convenient lie.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, and then there's that when he ends up having to do the soul gaze and he gets in there and then he sees what's happened to her.
Yeah. So what did you think of this?
It really took a turn. I was very surprised. I wasn't sure who he saw when he was in there.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's got to be the other vampire. What's her name? Madeline?
Madeline, yeah. I think that's who he thinks. Or Lara.
For some reason, I don't think Lara actually goes out and does stuff anymore. And that is not even a little bit true. But in my head, I decided that she barely even comes out anymore.
Well, that's an interesting thing because, I mean, it's not true that she doesn't do anything. But I think you're right about there being, like, layers between her and what she has done in her name.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So if she had gone out and done this herself, I think that feels a little weird. Like, she would have lackeys that would be able to, you know?
She would have people for that.
Yeah. So I understand why you sort of didn't even think of her in that respect. And yeah, it's like Harry realizes that this poor woman, because like he can tell when he's like, you better fucking tell me. She basically has like a lockup on her mouth. Mm-hmm. Where she's trying to tell him and she can't physically do it.
Mm-hmm.
And he can see that she's like a second away from kind of cracking and breaking completely because all of her rational mind and her emotions are in favor of telling him and yet she can't physically do it.
This was horrible to read.
Yeah.
I don't know if it hit anybody else, but it felt like so graphic to me. You know. Oh, I did not care for it.
Graphic in the description of her trying to speak and not being able to.
Right.
Yeah. And her eyes, like, darting around. It's like she's, like, trying to figure out what's happening to her or looking for a way to, like, get away from him, maybe, because he's the source of the distress. He's the one trying to get her to talk.
When he talks about how it looks like she's just seconds away from cracking, you're just like, oh, that... Yeah.
So yeah, he sees the silver eyes, and she's also like in the soul gaze. Her fucking brain, her soul, I guess, looks like her office, which I can't decide if that's awful or if that's kind of like best case scenario for your life, like. If you go into somebody's soul and they are living a life that is so exactly what they want, that what it looks like in their soul is where they are every day. Is that super depressing, or is that kind of like goals?
Oh, you just broke my brain a little bit.
You know what I'm saying? Because I'm not saying, like, is it a good thing or a bad thing to have your soul feel like an office? That's not relevant. It's what she wants, clearly. Whether I think it's good or bad.
Right.
And she has achieved it to such a degree that the place looks practically identical. I mean, I feel like I want to be jealous of that, if anything. Do you know what I mean?
Well, yeah, if her office really is her happy place, then yeah, that's where she gets to, you know, that's where her soul lives, then I think she's kind of on the right path. As opposed to some of us whose job is killing our souls.
Yeah, I feel like it, with somebody like that, we would sort of interpret what they're doing as like, oh, they need to loosen up, or they need a vacation, or whatever. And to see that, like, no, she's right where she wants to be, actually. This is, like, exactly, this is her vacation.
Right.
Not really, except, but, you know.
Except she's in lingerie in her soul.
Right, true. I guess that might not be a real soul gaze, then? Like, because she wouldn't be in lingerie in reality in her soul gaze, like, if she hadn't been tampered with. So would she be in her office if she hadn't been tampered with?
That's a better question, because maybe that's just where it happened. And yeah. So that's just where she is now. Hmm. Especially if you think about it being, not a natural death.
True. Yeah. You know. So, Harry comes out of the soul gaze, and she's got a real freaked out look on her face, and he's like,
up in his jam too.
Don't you want to fucking know what his soul looks like?
I can't believe they haven't told us yet.
Damn
books.
He says, I think he said that like Susan fainted or something when they soul gazed each other.
I can't remember.
And this woman he says that she looked in awe of him and then said, "Who are you?" So I'm just like, what did you see, though?
Oh, I want to know
so bad. I have no guesses.
I feel like it probably looks like
his apartment. Because he's such a homebody. He loves his little home.
Oh, I don't know. It could be his time with Ebenezer. It could be time with his dad before he even, like, came into the wizarding world proper.
It could be something that's, like, a complete construct as well. Because I think that, like, when he gazes... Remember that FBI agent in book two? Who Harry, when he soul gazes him, it's like obviously an idyllic, like all American town that has kind of gone bad. Do you remember how that one
just
was set up? It's supposed to be that basically this dude is like, he's fighting for this idealized version of Chicago, but he's so corrupt in trying to fight for it that it has rotted, like the whole concept of it in his head. And that wasn't exactly, I mean, Chicago is a place where he lives, but it wasn't exactly specifically Chicago. It was just like a perfect Rockwellian sort of American neighborhood.
Mm.
So I don't know that it would necessarily even have to be a place that's real. Like Thomas's soul gaze, he's like in this weird marble statue situation with this like mirror, right? That he's
I forgot all about that.
Yeah.
Oh, that's right.
You sound really freaked out now.
I am all over again.
So yeah, I mean, I'm saying that it would be like Harry's apartment, but I don't know that it would be anything that we even recognize necessarily. It could be like... Oh my god, it could be like Looney Tunes in there.
Oh my God, I was just going to say he could end up wherever his mother is, but you said Looney Tunes and yours is so much better.
Meep, meep.
Oh, shit.
How funny would it be?
Fantastic image.
That this woman comes out and is like, who are you? In response to da 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 da. Like, you really think that she has seen some shit. But then if you go into the soul gaze, you're like, wait, you reacted that way because of this? That's all, folks. So, yeah. Harry realizes that she is really fucked up. That, yeah. You know, some shit has happened to her.
Yeah, it did a lot of damage. Whatever was in there, messing around with her memories.
Mm-hmm. And he tells her that he is Harry Dresden, and she says she ran from you.
Mm-hmm.
Which means she was conscious of whatever that was in her head. Right. Which fucks me up.
Yeah, she was kind of like watching it like it was a movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I hate that. I hate it. Like, it was one thing to think that she didn't know what was going on. But to then find out that, like, when she comes out of it, she has some awareness that something is going on. And she asks Harry, what is happening to me?
How do you think she saw it? Do you think she saw it, like, as an out-of-body experience? I don't mean literally, but I'm talking about her viewpoint. Like, a out-of-body experience where she's, like, watching everything from above? Or do you think she saw it from inside her own eyes? Like, in her own body?
I feel like she heard it. Like, maybe, if we're going with one of the white court, she heard her whispering in her head, and then the whispering stopped, and interpreted that as she ran from you. But that's just my, like, guessing, because I feel like the actually looking through her eyes and seeing, like, I feel like that would do less good for whomever has tried to take her over than hearing what she's saying.
Okay.
Unless they had fucking, you know, surround sound and fucking HD. I don't know. Maybe they got both. There's no reason, I guess, to think that they didn't. Why? What was your interpretation of it?
I was hoping for more of an out-of-body experience kind of thing, because the idea of being trapped in a body where you're aware of what's going on around you, but you can't communicate.
Yeah.
It's so deeply upsetting to me.
Yeah.
That I didn't even want to think about it for too long.
So, yeah. He starts talking about mind magic. And it's a violation of the laws, but there are gray areas and there are accepted customs as to what was or was not allowed in practice. And he says that he can't do much for her because he's not real good at this stuff, but that somebody else might be able to undo some of the harm. Might. He's not even positive about that. There is one thing that he can do, and he sends her to sleep. I made her as comfortable as I could. With luck, when she woke, she would pass most of our confrontation off as a bad dream. And I'm like, you just said that they might not be able to undo the damage. You are going to let them know, right?
I mean, listen, he's going to come back and follow up on that, right?
I really hope that...
He's not just going to leave her sleeping in the fucking hallway or whatever the fuck.
You know? Like, I want him to go talk to the White Council... And be like, hey, somebody's out here doing some shit and damaged this woman and she, you know. But at the same time, I don't know how much letting the White Council know that he talked to this woman incriminates him in helping Morgan.
I would say no, he doesn't want to bring that up.
Yeah, I guess so. That sucks. Jesus. So she's just got to fucking deal with this, maybe. I hate it. That's not fair at all. So he says the White Court was involved. Oh, right. I forgot that he goes out and he just, like, uses Forzare to get his fucking...
Oh, my God. To get his fucking staff.
And the guard falls out of his chair and Harry just leaves without saying or doing anything further to
be like... Drama fucking queen.
He is, though. I want to see this shit on screen so bad. I really do. I know that, like... I think Butcher has gone on record as saying... If it ever got made into a TV show, he would want it to be illustrated rather than live action because there's so much magic that it would be really expensive to produce and be able to do adequately everything that needs doing. And so he would rather it be illustrated than have to pull back on a lot of the magic and and the enormity of some of like the set pieces with how many people are involved, you know, when there's armies and shit like that.
How do you think it would do as an animated series?
I don't know. That's hard for me to picture.
I don't think I like it.
I understand him feeling that way budget-wise, but in terms of it being, like, a good idea for the show, I'm just like, I don't know.
Yeah, I don't see it personally. Mm-mm.
The one thing that does get tiring is in the Dresden Files, like, Facebook groups, there is nothing but, like, who would you cast as so-and-so over and over and over again. It's gotten to the point that there are certain groups where, like, they have it in the rules that you don't make those posts, and if you make one as a noob who hasn't read the rules, they just boot you immediately. Like, the other one is this mouse? With a picture of a large dog. There's one other one that happens all the time, but yeah, there's a few that like immediately will get you booted because they just do it all the time. But I really just like, I honestly can't picture Harry. I have a really hard time imagining what he looks like. Like, is there any actor that kind of comes into your head when you're picturing him and what's happening in the books? Because with a lot of these characters, I have an image that it's unconscious. It's just like, this is who I think of, this actor. For Molly, I automatically think of the girl who plays Dawn in Buffy. I don't know why.
Oh.
For Karen, I automatically think of the woman who plays the sidekick cop in... and she's not even really a sidekick, but in Justified. And she's black. So it doesn't really work with her actual description of being a tiny blonde woman. But she is, in Justified, she is this, like, 5 foot tall fucking, like, dynamo. Really tough. And not, like, she has a sense of humor, but it's, like, it doesn't come out often. And she felt so right to me for this that I see her all the time. Harry, I don't have anybody. I don't have an actor in mind. He is the most difficult for me to picture. You know?
And even after watching the TV series, it didn't mess up.
He doesn't feel like Harry to me. No. I didn't find the TV series to be as bad as I thought it was going to be honest. But
really?
Yeah, like, it was... It's as bad as any sort of, like, low-budget magic TV show. You know? Right. There's a lot of them out there. They're all kind of not great. There are some exceptions, but mostly they're not great. It was as bad as any of those. But it wasn't... He just doesn't feel like Harry to me. He's too old, for one thing. I felt like when these begin, Harry's like in his mid-20s, I think, right?
I thought it was older than that.
I'm going to have to look into it. I feel like we've had this conversation before.
I think we have.
But yeah, I don't know. And it will be brought up in groups all the time, and I'm constantly shocked at how other people picture him. You know what I mean? Like, people will be like, don't you think this person would make a great Harry? And I'm like, really? It's not even just disagreeing. It's just being floored that that person was even on the table. It says that he is now 37 years old. As of the book Cold Days. So if there are 16 books so far, 17th coming, And they each took place over about a year or so. Let's just subtract 10 years, like, off the top. So he was, like, 27, maybe 25 at the start of book one.
Damn, so, yeah. I thought he was older than that.
Yeah. So, yeah, I don't know. Everybody, like, people bring up actors that are, like, I think much too old to play Harry unless we're starting with, like, present-day Harry. And I think the problem is that I'm just too old to know of a lot of young actors anymore. Do you know what? I think that's what it is. I'm fucking out of touch.
I am sitting here racking my brain trying to think of at least one person. I can't think of a fucking person.
Who's the kid who played Lori on The New Little Women? Timothy Chalamet?
Okay.
Oh, I love that you just were like, uh-huh. He actually has a really angular face, and I think it has, like, a kind of a playful vibe to him. He could, in a few years, he's too young now, but I feel like he could pull off being a Harry Dresden. But other than that, I got nothing. And I literally picked him out of a hat because he's, like, the one young actor that I know his name. So there it is. Anyway, okay. So, sorry, guys. So, yeah, the end of the chapter is Harry walking out of there, and he is really fucking angry.
Yeah, because he's furious.
They can go out, and they can feed on people, and, you know, all of this is sort of unavoidable if they are going to continue to stay alive. But this is different. This bitch got into somebody's head.
Mm-hmm. Coming into his town, fucking around with his people.
Mm-hmm.
He's not here for it.
And they're trying to get him killed and Morgan killed. Which is particularly odd. Like, what is their interest in this?
Mm-hmm.
How do they even know Morgan is with him? Like, how this happen? You know,
yeah. And, you know, not that I believe anything nefarious is afoot, but where the fuck is Thomas?
Mm-hmm.
Which is how the last chapter ended.
Yeah, I mean, if it weren't for the fact that this woman says she ran from you, one could be forgiven for wondering what the fuck, if maybe that wasn't Thomas's silver eyes, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But I think if there's also a description of, like, long hair or something, so maybe not.
Yeah, I think it's supposed to be clear that it's a woman. But yeah. I would like to know what the fuck. So, I thought that was going to get dealt with in this chapter, and it did not. It didn't even come up.
Yeah. Yeah, I think Harry's just kind of, like, he's taking the same approach as he did with when Thomas was just being really weird and cagey about where he worked. I think he's not positive anything bad happened to Thomas so much as he's just like, I'm going to trust that he's, like, able to take care of shit.
Mm-hmm.
Because really, that's probably just the most expedient course of action right now. He doesn't, there's nothing he can do.
Right.
He has nothing to go on.
Right.
So he kind of just has to be like, I hope he's okay and can handle whatever the hell is going on. And that's, like, all he can offer right now.
Mm-hmm.
Which, that sucks.
I would like some answers. Harry Dresden might not need them, but I need them.
Are you still thinking that it was the menace?
Well, you know, I was not expecting the fairy charm thing, right?
Oh, for Morgan hiding?
For Morgan. So I had been thinking, like, something supernatural was also following them. And I couldn't think of anything else but the menace. I was like, okay, that works. But it could have been, like, something fairy related. Maybe the menace is fairy related.
That's an interesting thought.
Huh. So what the fuck was I going to say? I lost my train of thought. I'm sorry. I just thought of the fucking thing being a fairy and it completely derailed my thought.
Well, there was another theory that I was going to ask you about. Now I fucking forgot what it was, because now I'm thinking about the menace being a fairy too. So thanks for that. Thanks for ruining my fucking mind. I'm going to say that it's probably not, but like, fairy has gotten involved with some weird shit before. So I don't feel like there's any guarantee of just being like, well, even if it's not actually of fairy, there's no reason to think that somebody in fairy wouldn't be working with it. Like,
right.
They don't necessarily keep shit in their own backyard.
And what was the conclusion we came to about Binder in this chapter? At the beginning, when Molly is talking to them, and she's saying how if Thomas had been the one to dime them out, wouldn't they have known exactly which storage unit they were in?
Right.
Did we ever circle back to that? Did they decide who they thought told Binder that they were at the storage place?
No, they just kind of realized, like, that's enough to keep Morgan from continuing on his, like, shitting all over Thomas.
Right.
Okay. But that doesn't actually give them an answer. It's just theorized that maybe it could be one of the Fae, because the agreement they have with Morgan does not preclude that.
Right.
But they don't really have an answer. It's just like, well, maybe.
Huh.
Yeah. What are you thinking?
Nope, nothing.
I love how quickly you said nope. You're not going to get me on tape saying something stupid. I have news for you, ma'am. About the show. All right, well, I guess we can wrap up then. Reminder to everybody, if you want Rashawn and I to cover A Song of Ice and Fire, go become a patron, patreon.com/unspoiled. We are 85% of the way there. Also, Rashawn, I need to talk to you about the next season of fucking Westworld that's coming up.
Because
we had been covering that, and I don't know whether you want to keep that up or what, when that's coming out or what. I haven't been looking into it.
We'll have to talk about that.
I didn't watch the trailer or anything because I'm trying to just keep my brain empty, as per usual. And I, you know, we'll see. But anyway, yeah, guys, patreon.com/unspoiled. And do me a favor and also check out War for the Tower, which is a live action, or a live action. It's an actual play, RPG podcast set in the world of Stephen King's The Dark Tower, and they are a sponsor of the show. Their ads have been on the Doctor Who show for a while now, but they were on this show for a minute. But yeah, if you're into Dark Tower, if you like role-playing game podcasts, and if you weren't thrilled with the way the Dark Tower ended, like I wasn't, which I also covered Dark Tower, so you guys can check that out also if you're a fan. You may want to check that out. So it's warforthetower.com or search War for the Tower in your podcatcher. I think that's about everything. Owen and I are continuing on with coverage of Avatar as the wedding fundraiser. And you guys can find those episodes to purchase for $1 on unspoiledpodcast.com/shop, I believe. And it has been going pretty well. We just reached an episode that was like in memory of Mako, and I just fucking lost my mind and burst into tears. So get ready for that to be something that we talk about. And I think that's everything. Is there anything else you want to add, ma'am?
No, ma'am.
All right. Well, thank you guys all so much for listening. I hope that you are enjoying the show, and we will see you next week with a new episode. Or wait, no. Wait, yes. No. Next week is the week you're gone, right?
That is right.
Okay. We will see you the week after next. Rashawn is going to be going away for a week. So there will be an empty day. So if people come at me and are like, where's the episode? I will know that you turn this show off before you listen to the very end, and I will judge you. It's also, if people come at me and want to know where it is, I will be laughing, because there was a week that I just forgot to post it, or it just didn't, for some reason, like about 3 weeks ago, and nobody said anything to me. Everybody just, I guess, assumed that I had like announced that there wasn't going to be one, or that they had just missed it, and nobody said anything until I posted the episode the next week and had clean skipped over one. And everybody was like, hey, what's going on? You didn't post the other ones. What are you doing? And I was like, wait, what? So, yeah. I am hoping
that... makes you feel good.
Right? I was just kind of like, okay, I will... Now I guess you get two this week, so have fun with that. But it was a weird thing, because sometimes it's like people are just like sitting refreshing their page, and the instant that it doesn't go up, they're like, where is it? But this was the opposite. Nobody noticed or cared. Anyway, so yeah, we won't have an episode next week, but we will come at you the week after. All right, everybody. Thank you again for listening. Toodaloo, motherfuckers.
Bye, guys.